Good evening, Prime Ministers, Ministers, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this celebration of the 40th anniversary of the Nordic Investment Bank. I was thinking a little bit about what to use if it was a celebration or an anniversary, but considering the time of day and the company, I decided that this is a celebration because this is a celebration of 40 years of successful Nordic cooperation. My name is Thomas Bernt Henriksen, I'm the op-ed editor of the Danish business newspaper Borsen and also the newspaper's economics correspondent, so it's a big pleasure to be here for a day which is really where the topic is economics, and which I think the main speaker that we'll introduce later on is a testament to. What we'll do tonight is to reflect on the work of NIB and consider the role of governments and finance in the future. But my biggest role tonight is actually to stick to the timetable. And therefore, it's a pleasure to, and actually an honor to introduce our first speaker, the Prime Minister of Finland and the Chairman of the Nordic Council of Ministers, Mr. Juha Sipilä. Welcome, the floor is yours.
This is not on. Now it's on. I knew that this remote control is not working, but is it too loud still? All right. But since this is a birthday, not a funeral, we should also do our very best to look into the future. Nordic Investment Bank, NIB, as we call it, is a child of Nordic cooperation, although this child birth was back in time a rather long one. In fact, the first attempt to establish the bank was made already in the 1950s in connection with the unrealized plans for Nordic Customs Union. The second attempt came as part of the preparation for the Nordic Economic Union, Nordek, which also failed. Well, even we Nordics can't always succeed. After the collapse of Nordek, it took another 5 years for the Nordic countries to make the third attempt. This time against the backdrop of oil crisis, the negotiations proceeded rather rapidly. And finally, the ministers for Nordic cooperation signed the agreement establishing the bank. In 1976, the bank started its operations. But this didn't happen without some heated debates. Among others, some representatives from the right wing of political spectrum in Norway and Denmark thought that the bank was too left-wing, whereas the Finnish communists were against the bank for exactly the opposite reason. So to us in the political center, it was a perfect solution. Another issue debated at that time was the location of the bank's headquarters. Finns were eager to have the bank in Helsinki, which was still lacking an important Nordic institution. It is said that it was thanks to Swedish Prime Minister Olof Palme that Helsinki was finally chosen. He saw that Nordic Investment Bank would bring Finland closer to the Nordic community. From then on, the headquarters has been located in Helsinki, and by the way, that is not the only presence the bank has in Helsinki. Today, if you arrive at the airport in Helsinki for a meeting at the bank's headquarters, much of the infrastructures around you has received NIB funding. the airport, the ring road, the ring rail, metro, the university, library, and so on. NIB may not be very visible, but the projects it finances are. Since 1976, NIB has agreed over 600 loans, totaling over 10 billion euro in my country. The world has changed dramatically since the 1970s. Most importantly for us, Baltic countries restored their independence in 1991. At that time, the economics were rather weak, and there were some serious environmental concerns too. After years of increased cooperation, the Baltic countries joined Nordic Investment Bank in 2005. That was truly important milestone for us all. Earlier today, when I met my colleagues from Nordic and Baltic countries, we all agreed that NIB is not only the child of Nordic cooperation, today it's also the most concrete institute of the Nordic-Baltic cooperation. For many years, regional cooperation in the Northern Europe seems to be overshadowed by deepening integration in the European Union. But as we all know, recent years have shown that the European process is not without its hiccups. An important note to take for us policymakers is that the different aspects of regional cooperation are not substitutes but complementary to each other. In fact, the importance of the Nordic-Baltic cooperation seems to be only growing right now. When NIB was established, financial markets were not functioning as well as they are today. Back then, NIB was a tool for raising capital to speed up investments in the Nordic region. It was also a tool to facilitate the integration of the economics by, for example, financing cross-border mergers and acquisitions. Later, this approach was complemented by environmental considerations. Nordic Investment Bank's contribution to financing St. Petersburg wastewater treatment facilities is a good example of that. Since 2006, the mission of the bank has been formalized as financing projects that improve competitiveness and the environment of its member countries. And what is NIB today? It's an international financing institution owned by the Nordic and Baltic countries. The bank has a strong standing in international financial markets, which is supported by strength of its member countries. The bank's outstanding lendings is about 16 billion euro. This is a large portfolio for a bank with less than 200 employees. Unlike many other international financial institutions, its operations are based on sound banking principles, and it pays a healthy dividend to its owners. Nordic Investment Bank's added value for its customers is a long-term lending, as the bank may extend loans up to 30 years. Professor Mazzucato, who will speak later this evening, has called this kind of funding source patient capital. It's a good phrase, since many long-term investments need long-term money. The commercial sector is often impatient, and innovations that move society forward often require a push from the state. An ideal situation, the state and the commercial sector work together. NIB is one of the platforms where this kind of cooperation takes place. The bank's member countries, as well as of European countries, it's a good for remember that our well-being is based on decisions and achievements of past. But the biggest risk for our region would be to rest on those past achievements. Changes in the global economy will transform us very quickly into the heroes of yesterday, if we don't react in time. This brings me why NIB is so valuable to us, the member countries. NIB is a tool for us to move our societies forward through long-term financing. With only 8 members, each of the owners has an equally significant impact, which is less the case in bigger multinational organizations. However, we could ask ourselves, are we bold enough as owners? Are we really financing the next step? Should we use NIB more, for example, by accepting a bit more risk for bigger social gain? NIB needs to develop at all the time. It needs to be agile and provide value added in the region. And also we, the member countries, have to keep evolving all the time. Professor Mazzucato will show us where are the financing unprecedented challenges in terms of smart, sustainable and inclusive growth. Ladies and gentlemen, with these words I would like to congratulate Nordic Investment Bank, our bank, on its 40th anniversary and give the floor to Henrik Normann, the president of NIB. Thanks.
It was a stormy and dark, stormy night in the 1970s. It was a brown and very orange decade. At that time, far-sighted politicians decided to establish NIB. And as was just said, the purpose was to attract capital to the region and see to better Nordic integration. So if we look at numbers, and a banker will always look at numbers, let's see the equity paid in by you, the shareholders, taxpayers, was 278 million euros. That has grown organically to 3.1 billion euros over the 40 years. At the same time, more or less close to 3 times the amount paid in has been paid out as dividend to the owners, so the taxpayers has benefited that way. And but much more importantly, NIB has been involved in close to 2,000 projects in the region. And on the capital side, 90% of the money, what we call funding, has been obtained outside the region. But instead of me boring you now, why not, and telling the story, why not show the story?
The early and mid-70s was a turbulent period in the global economy because of the oil crisis, where some of the countries who imported oil, including the Nordic countries, were severely hit. So it was quite natural that the Nordic countries started to discuss how to create really long-term investment bank together. And that was really the start of the Nordic Investment Bank. It gave a possibility for the Nordic countries to co-finance, co-fund long-term infrastructure projects in a situation where the global economy was quite turbulent.
The bank starts to operate in August 1976. The headquarter is decided to be placed in Helsinki.
Prime Minister Palme, I think he was quite pleased actually having Helsinki as the headquarter, because he said it will tie Finland more closely to the Nordic community and not take a little step away from Moscow.
Investeringsbanken, investeringsbanken.
Det här nordiska samarbetet ser man med allt större intresse på, och det är intressant att låna till Norden.
At that time, the role of NIB was to bring in long-term capital from the international market, and on the other hand, to also support cross-border activities within the Nordic countries.
Responsible growth gained credibility, as well as need for more capital.
We were extremely cautious of establishing an institution that would, from the very beginning, be credible in the international capital markets.
In 1982, the frontmen of NIB traveled to New York for decisive appointments.
I joined them in New York to visit the credit rating agencies, Standard & Poor's and Moody's. We were advocating, of course, the best possible rating for NIB. This is really the backbone of the business, because this is the reason why NIB can be a positive supplement to other sources of financing.
Credibility becomes a scarce asset only a few years later.
All over the Nordic region, you had, within a certain period of time, you had deregulation of the financial sector. It turned out that the banking crisis started in 1991. Of course, I was here at the time and living through this. The demand of on funds from NIB increased quite strongly in that period, because the commercial banks became more reluctant to longer-term financing.
Economic turbulence in the West is accompanied by a political collapse in the East. In August 1991, the Baltic countries declare their independence.
The Baltic economies were in a very sorrow state. And on top of the poor economic conditions, they were facing serious environmental problems.
The region is starving for funding to start rebuilding their economies and societies.
And NIB obviously had the closeness to these countries as a good reason for showing them support. This was also good business sense, because the business opportunities that eventually would appear when the market began to operate.
In 2005, the Baltic countries become members of the NIB.
Joining the Nordic Investment Bank was very important, because through the bank we joined the society.
The Baltic Sea also connects the member countries to a growing environmental concern.
A lot of the credits given by the financial sector to industrial projects have caused environmental degradation, and it is necessary for the financial sector to help clean up.
And then you have to ask yourself, so what could the contribution of an institution like NIB be? We'd identified two things. One was to support competitiveness in the areas where you needed long-term capital. And the other thing was to support the environment.
With the new strategy, the sustainability evaluation becomes a significant feature of the NIB mandate.
First of all, we are a bank. So what we have to do when we are approaching a customer, we want our money back. And so you have to look at a project, is it healthy? So that's one thing. Every bank will do that. But then where we are different, then we have a mandate. So either it's a green mandate or it's competitiveness. Then you make the analysis and saying, what effect does this project have on the environment?
Accomplishing the mandate of sustainable growth, NIB has supported Iceland's transition from fossil to renewable energy production.
What you need is vision. You need a government political vision to move ahead with these projects, and then funding that's willing to have the long-term view. I think there's great potential for utilizing more renewable energy around the world.
A publicly owned financial institution like NIB has an inbuilt variable that will change with the needs of the society.
We want to reach out to a broader range of potential clients, more SMEs, more mid-caps, and we want to make sure that we stay relevant to our large customers. And that might mean, in some cases, actually funding more projects outside the region. The NIB is certainly striving to fulfill the mandates given by the owners, and that is to increase competitiveness, to increase sustainable growth, to increase the catch-up of the Baltics. These are very important common objectives. But apart from that, I think it's important to remember that the NIB is a bank, and what we do best is banking.
When you watch this very nice film, you have to ask yourself a very deep philosophical question, and that is, why does everybody hate bankers? You are at a dinner party, you are enjoying yourself, you tell your dinner companion that you are a banker, and whips, you are sitting there alone, and you start playing with the breadcrumbs. And you become very good, I can build a small pyramid now. And then you begin to think of life, and you get depressed. And you think about the financial crisis. We are not over it yet, really. Low interest rates, it's impossible to run a bank. In the next 5 to 10 years, there will be a cyber attack on banking infrastructure. It will be difficult to get your money out for a day or two. What have the politicians thought about that? Terrorism, there will be a terrorist attack in Europe, no doubt about that, a major one. Pandemics, immigration, and I can go on and on. And then we are also pollution and so on, global warming. But when you look at the history of NIB and you look back to the 70s, what was the 70s? You had an oil shock, right? In the Nordics, you had the fiscal cliff. The public finances were quite poor, to be very blunt. You had terrorism in Germany. You have hijacking all over the world. We see security has gone up. You had population growth, which was a big problem. And poverty, global poverty. And really, you had also pollution, life-threatening pollution. And talking about pollution, if you go just outside this building, you have Copenhagen Harbor. I moved to Copenhagen in the start of the 1970s, when you took a nice stroll along the harbor, and by accident you dropped your Kodak movie in the water. When you took it out, it was developed, because there was so much chemicals in the water that you couldn't touch it. in the last 10 years, we have actually been able to swim in Copenhagen Harbor all year round. The same in other major cities around the Baltic Sea. That is life quality. That is improvement. And by the way, we don't measure yet in GDP. And that is the result of you here in the room that has ensured that basically the sea quality in the Baltic Sea have been reduced. There are still big problems. The interesting part is, to take an example, Kaliningrad, the disbursement there is 140,000 cubic meter of raw sewage. Belarus, which is not even bordering the Baltic Sea, is one of the major polluters through two rivers through the Baltic countries. So there are still things to do and things to finance. So if you look here at the graph, you can actually see that we are beginning the hiccup here, that is a lot of rainfall that can actually mean that the sewage system will disperse a lot for a very short period of time. But we are back to the 1920s very soon if we look at the cleanness. And that has led to that we are having increased biodiversity in the region. Basically, we are doing better on all accounts. But it also takes money if we want to improve the environment. It's not cheap. And there we have to face one thing we as NB8 people really don't like to realize. We live in the outskirts of Europe. And we all know that growth is lower in the outskirts. The ebbing center of political will is moving away from us, Brexit, towards Central Europe. US is focusing much more on Asia. That's life, and that's important for us, because if we want to persevere, we have to have growth. And thank God, you can say, even though we complain, and Thomas, the moderator, his newspaper complains all the time about the lack of competitiveness, but nevertheless, we are still in the top 20, but it is something that is needed in order to secure that we live in a green environment, and also that we avoid social unrest. So basically, you have to ask yourself, why is he mentioning this? What can NIB do about this? Because we are a small bank. And I'll give you an example of what we can do and where an institution like ours come in. Here you see a number of the projects that we do finance, but let's take one out here. This is just on the other side of Öresund, Max 4 Lab. I really hate this slide because I cannot explain what they do there. But basically, it's an electron accelerator where the electrons can get up to the speed of lightning. And by doing that, you can take X-rays of matter. So you can take medicine, you can take solar cells, you can go in and then you can look at the molecules, and then you can basically go in and design products significantly more efficient. Max 4 Lab is the most efficient in the world. It's the cheapest to use. It has been financed by Sweden and a number of other countries that has wanted to build this. NIB is involved. We have given financing 1.5 billion Swedish kroner for 24 years. Would MaxLab has been built without NIB? Self-evidently, it would have been built. But if they should have commercial financing, today the markets don't like to give banks money for much more than 10 years. We have here central banker and regulators and so on in the room, but the trust in banks are not there yet. So we can see that senior capital costs money. There we have the advantage that we can be additionality to the financial system and do something they can't do. So NIB's job is not to compete with the financial system, but to give additionality to try to rule and help with smaller cracks in the system. But if you think about it, to give loans of 24 years, the longest loan we have given in my tenure, that is 35 years. And that is completely nuts, just so you know. Because think back what happened since 1981, the Baltic states were not independent at that time. The reason we can do this, and we dare do it, and we do make money, is that we are also having another advantage in the region, and that is where you should be a bit proud of yourself, whether you are from industry or whether you are politicians. The more yellow, the better up here. The more transparency there is, the less corruption there is, the better legal framework there is, the more level playing field there is. And without good law, it is impossible to give long-term loans. So I think that is actually one of the key issues and key takeaways, that we have to maintain this transparency. And there we need a good critical press, and it is appalling to see what is happening around the world, and you can basically see that there is a close link between the press. That was just to please the moderator, because we are not paying him, so we have to give him a bit of a... But also, if we look at this, when you read the newspapers, as I started out to say, it seems like we are dying, all of us. But if we are looking at what is happening in the region, where the dotted line is the growth and the growth projections, and where you see CO2 emissions, basically the world is improving. But why are we not discussing that? I know it doesn't make headlines to write "No murder in Copenhagen yesterday," but nevertheless, if we look at the things that we have achieved, I think I will quote Professor Ian Golding from Oxford University. He has coined it very nicely, and he is saying, perhaps we are at the verge of a new renaissance. Because if you look at the technological breakthrough that we are having, look at medicine, look at the genome. Soon we will have medicine that is age-dependent and gender-dependent, race-dependent, which is significantly more efficient than today. So that's just one example. Clean energy is another example. And do you know what? In the Nordics, we are actually quite well positioned if you look at the clusters we have here in medicine, clean energy, sea transport. So it's a bit difficult to understand why we are having this general pessimism. I will, though, remind you that the Renaissance was probably the most unpeaceful period in history, where there was war all over Europe because there was upheaval, there was new knowledge coming out. So new knowledge creates uncertainty, and that is perhaps one of the things that we are doing today. But the interesting thing from a banker's perspective is that if we look at our region, there is no lack of capital. I'm sorry to say so. If we go out, banks can finance generally everything. What there is a lack of is long-term financing. But at the moment, if you have a good project, you can do it. And the problem with the low interest rate, in my view, is that there is some debt swaps that you buy back equities and you replace your equity with swap instead of investing. But what our board have said to us, to live up to the first speech from the Prime Minister, is basically we have to prepare ourselves, because we should be slightly anti-cyclical. We are a small bank, but we have to prepare if there is a crisis, that there are certain areas that should have special attention, and I have listed them there on the screen. So this is how we see NIB. Not transformational, but a small wheel where you decide basically what we should do and how we should look at the future. Because the future could be grim. But there we have invited Professor Mazzucato here. And the reason we have invited her is an old story about Professor Einstein, who was sitting comfortably in Princeton when his secretary comes in and tells him, "Professor Einstein, it's horrible, it's awful. You are asking exactly the same questions as you did last year for your students in PhD." He thinks a bit and he looks at her and then he says, it doesn't matter at all. You see, I have changed the answers. And that's what it is about, isn't it? That if you are a politician, business head, it is to have the right product. It is to basically go in and say, how do we create wealth for the masses? How do we define the future? And the reason we have invited you is that we, to these old questions, need new answers. We need more growth. We need more work, because progress is not automatic. We are lucky because you have been good at what you are doing. We are the stars at the moment, but it is not a certainty. So I hope that you will inspire us, and I would like to say thank you for the support to everybody. I would like to say thank you to the board. I would say thank you to everybody. This is not a Oscar Academy Award, so I don't will not say thank you for 5 minutes, but I think I'll just send one message, and that is, you decide what we should do, but we are open for business. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Henrik. I just have to correct one thing. You said we complained about competitiveness all the time in my newspaper. We complain much more about the awful growth figures for the country. But that's another thing. What will the future bring for NIB? And to answer that question, Henrik has almost already introduced our keynote speakers today. And to understand that question, we need to understand economics, but we also, and that's why this is a good place to be, we also need to understand politicians. It is this interplay between politics and economics, I think, that is the key behind NIB, but also the key behind how we solve today's problems. Therefore, a plot to NIB for inviting one of the most insightful thinkers today on the role of the government in our economies. And to speak on the theme of innovation policy shaping markets for smart and inclusive growth. I'll highlight this growth thing, but that's a personal remark, of course. So welcome, Mariana Mazzucato. You are the R.M. Phillips Professor at University of Sussex. You are the author of the, and I think many of you perhaps know the book, author of the award-winning bestseller, The Entrepreneurial State, which was also shortlisted for Best Book of the Year in 2013. You are an economics advisor to both the Scottish Government and the Labour Party, and is also a member of the Global Agenda Council for the World Economic Forum. So, but I know you fly all over the world. And I know, for those who are interested, that you're just ready, or just published a new book, along with Michael Jacobs, on rethinking capitalism. The floor is yours.
Thank you. So, thank you very much for inviting me, and what great speeches to have come before. You really set up the stage for me. And in fact, in some ways, I was thinking what you really described was the, Henrik, the potential role of public banks, not just to be lenders of last resort, but investors of first resort. And what that actually implies is, again, sort of changing the kinds of economic questions we ask about what the role is of economic policy per se. And I actually want to begin with that bigger umbrella point of, in such a challenging time where we are explicitly facing the point that growth doesn't just have a rate, it has a direction, and that this direction is increasingly being talked about in terms of, you know, smart innovation-led growth, sustainable growth, and inclusive growth. If you've read Piketty's great book, you'll know inequality is rising due to all sorts of rent extraction. Then what does this actually mean for public policy beyond just enabling and creating the background conditions? How can policy and the different types of public institutions steer growth in this way? And this is a huge, huge question. And in fact, I want to first argue, and this is a bit the depressing part of the story, but then I'll reverse it, that we are actually living through quite a dark time in terms of this question. We are, I think, in sort of the last two decades, there's been, in some ways, a retreat of the role of policy beyond just enabling, facilitating, de-risking, you know, these framework conditions that we all talk about, which are important, and the rule of private property, that we have to protect it, and we need good judicial systems, and we need to reduce corruption, et cetera, et cetera. But this role of somehow policy is just being in the background, leveling the playing field, misses the first point that I just mentioned, which is, if actually growth has a direction, what does it mean to think about how to tilt the playing field in that direction? By the way, I should also just say from the beginning, just so that we don't have misunderstandings, every time I say the word public policy or state, do not think of a big ministry, sort of top-down, big brother thinking through exactly how we want to tilt that playing field. What I'm going to try to convince you about is how, in the few places in the world and regions in the world that have in fact achieved smart innovation-led growth, there's been a decentralized network of dynamic public actors in the economy that have in fact been able to work with the private sector, the third sector, and even, in some instances, civil society to achieve interesting transformational objectives. Now, I'm an economist, and in economics, one of the ways in which this sort of lame scenario is set up in terms of just facilitating is this assumption that there's this market out there, and every now and then it screws up, and public policy has to come in to fix different types of market failures. And really what I want to be arguing, and I hope this is going to be really useful for your investment bank, is that what we actually need is a very different framework through which we justify banks like NIB, but in fact any mission-oriented public organization. Because in fact, what we've seen is the need for market making and market shaping, not just market fixing. But let me just pause a minute and explain this figure, because it's really important, because I'm sure probably even in some of your own documents you have had to show which market failures you're fixing. And these failures do exist. The most obvious one, by the way, with innovation, which is my field, is when you have a public good, like basic research, it's really hard for any private company, forget just the cost of basic research, even if they had the money to spend on basic research, it's very hard to appropriate privately the rewards from it. Why? Because there's huge spillovers. So knowledge creates great spillovers, and this is why we call it a public good. It has very strong positive externalities. So you have underinvestment by the private sector in basic research and science, and this is not very controversial at all. This is why across the world you have public entities of different types financing science. Now, you might have on the opposite side some negative externalities like pollution, where you need the state to come in and fix that problem with a bandage. Ideally they would, but they don't do it enough, you know, through things like carbon taxes. Now, all these different types of failures in the market do exist, but what I want to argue is that they would not help us explain these transformational changes that have actually occurred over history, where in fact you needed different types of public institutions to do much more than just fix these different types of market failures. And we are fed this probably also in Borsen, but especially in The Economist and papers of this sort, and you were basically telling me that more or less you're aligned with The Economist, where every single week, and I love The Economist, but the only thing I don't like about it is the editorial, because it's like cut and paste every week, which is, you know, all the great stuff is in business, and the state has to learn how to just fix these market failures. They don't use that word. They say, you know, stick to the basics, fund the skills, fund the infrastructure, fund the science base, do kind of the background, but then get the hell out of the way for the revolutionaries in the private sector to do their thing. And so this constant depiction, this narrative, this discourse, this cartoon image, right, of the boring state being necessary, but, you know, a bit inertial, but yes, we need it, but, you know your place. You're there to enable, to create background conditions in order for the real actioneers to do their thing, the wealth creators, this term that we often hear, the wealth creators. And again, what I actually want to argue, and I think this is a very important point, by the way, for those who think they're on the sort of progressive left, is that we really need to rethink this discourse and this cartoon image. so that the way we talk about the public sector is not just in terms of wealth redistribution through the welfare state, et cetera, but even as critical to the wealth creation process itself. Wealth is co-created. Even the market, by the way, the term market is often misused. What is the market? The market's not business. Those are two different things. The market is an outcome of the interactions between different actors, public actors, different types of public actors, and not all are as mission-oriented as I'll be speaking about in a minute, different types of companies with different types of corporate governance, different types of size. Third sector actors are increasingly important in areas like life sciences, but also civil society. We wouldn't have weekends, right, without the trade union movement. We would not be working only 8 hours a day without the civil society pressures to fight for certain very important battles. And all these different forces create the market. And this is quite interesting, actually, because in economics, we don't admit this, right? We say the market. And in fact, companies themselves, by the way, often use the term market pressures to justify certain kind of dysfunctional practices, which I'll be getting to towards the end, this increasing financialization of the real economy where profits are not reinvested back in. They say the market sort of pressurized us to do that. But once we say the market is an outcome, one of the first things is that we realize that actually one of the roles of public policy, as I mentioned in the beginning, is about shaping and co-creating that market. And in economics, we don't really have that terminology. And I want to argue that this has created real problems for both the justification of the investments, for example, that you make, but also the measurement, the evaluation, the assessment. And I've been personally very inspired by the work of Karl Polanyi, who was more of a historian, sociologist. This great book he wrote in 1944 called The Great Transformation was really quite exceptional, because what he did was he looked at the evolution of markets across the world since the beginning of capitalism, and basically found that, and it's absolutely a wonderful anthropological work, found that local markets, kind of the markets on the corner of the street where you buy fruit and vegetables across the world, or international markets through trade, have actually predated capitalism by thousands of years. Those kinds of markets existed, but the capitalist national market, first of all, it's recent, right, about 250, 300 years old, and it was deeply sort of shaped but literally forced into existence through public policy. And this already should set up the conversation very, very differently. So it's not that you have the market and different types of policies intervene in the market, and some might argue good to intervene, some might say don't intervene. That word intervention already sets up the problem wrongly. Keynes himself, by the way, I think has been misinterpreted by his own followers. He wasn't talking just about the government to be counter-cyclical, but actually to think big. This quote, I think, is great in this wonderful piece he wrote, The End of Laissez-Faire, where he says, the role of public policy is not just to tinker on the edges, make things a little bit better, a little bit worse, but to really be doing what's not being done at all, that additionality that you were talking about, Henrik. But not just additionality in terms of investments, even envisioning a new future. So this whole smart, inclusive, sustainable growth needs to be thought about, needs to be concretized also with particular ways to dream around specific missions, whether it was going to the moon in the past or fighting climate change today in concrete ways, for example, like Germany is doing through its energy event policy. That's the role of public policy. Now, sorry for this very self-promotional slide, but when your book is translated in German as Das Kapital des Staat, it's actually kind of nice to see it up there, because I don't think it'll ever happen again that any book I write is called Das Kapital. But I think that's a really interesting title, because in fact what I'm talking about and what I will be talking about in my remaining 34 minutes, if hopefully I won't bore you too much, is precisely that, the capital of the state. How do we start talking about the state through its different types of institutions? And public banking, by the way, is increasingly important, and I'll show you some data later. How do we talk about the state as investor, as a visionary dreamer, creating a new landscape, dynamizing in, not just crowding in, the private sector? And what does that mean for big questions that I want to address in a minute? But especially, what does it mean literally for the terminology? You know, beyond enabling and leveling, but actually creating a portfolio of different areas, and how do we actually track what that portfolio is doing in terms of also remaining broad and not, you know, putting all eggs in one basket. And I want to sort of focus my remaining time around these big four questions that I think are actually quite crucial for changing the conversation from a market-fixing one to a market-shaping and creating one, and hopefully, and this is actually becoming a project that I'm setting up in a new center, which I'll be announcing in a month or so, but forget that part, which is how do we change the conversation, for example, from one where we're always worrying about don't pick winners, right? I don't know if you have this terminology here, but often we say, you know, the state should not pick a direction, it should facilitate, but the direction itself should be chosen by the market, so the state should not, through any activity it does, pick a particular technology, a particular firm, or a particular direction. So this first point is to say, you know what, that's a stupid sort of question. We have always had to make strategic choices. There has been agency, consciousness. Almost everything that's interesting that has happened in the last 200 years was picked. The real question is how. How do we actually pick broadly defined directions, something that I'm going to be calling missions, so problem-specific directions, and how can we learn how that occurred, for example, in places like Silicon Valley? So instead of saying, don't pick winners, have a really more interesting and dynamic understanding of how this picking, choosing, deciding strategic agency actually did occur in interesting places, from Israel's Yozma program, it's a public venture capital fund, to DARPA, to your own Nordic Investment Bank, to the Brazilian Development Bank, which up until a year ago was extremely active, but also how these different agencies and organizations interacted with something that one of your actors there, not actors, who was she, the woman in your video who talked about the need for public vision, how do these choices relate then to a much higher level vision that a government might have? How do we talk about organizations within the public sector so that, or how do we build organizations in the public sector that are able to deal with this massive, if you want, challenge of picking? What does it mean to, for example, welcome failure? Given that actually most of the successes, which I'll talk about very soon, they only occurred because on the way, someone tripped and fell and made lots of errors, trial and error and error and error, and hopefully learning from those errors. So how do you build learning organizations in the public sector, which unfortunately we don't talk about enough? People go to business schools and learn about strategic management, decision sciences. The finance minister of Latvia was just telling me that you have an MBA. I'm sure you studied great courses around these areas, organizational behavior, et cetera, in the private sector. But because we've dismissed the public sector as doing anything more than enabling and leveling the playing field, these huge organizational issues have not been really studied. Third, how do we assess, evaluate these investments? Because it's no good to argue for mission-oriented investments in different areas, whether it's in green or health, if then as soon as you're evaluated, you're told you're crowding out the private sector. And in fact, many of the crowding out evaluations that I've seen, including, by the way, with the BBC, the British Broadcasting Corporation, which the world benefits from because of their very high quality, over the last year has gone through a charter review looking at its role, and it's been fascinating to me to see how badly it was evaluated. By badly, I mean in a really static way. If you are a dynamic public entity which has, in fact, shaped and created a market, or co-created the market, instead of just fixed it, what does that mean for creating evaluation measures which can capture that dynamic aspect? And lastly, since this is not just about socializing risks and privatizing rewards, but actually getting this new narrative of wealth as having been created collectively through different types of risk takers and investors, what does that mean for new ways that we can think about how to socialize also the rewards, not just the risks, in order to achieve greater public value, but especially in order to achieve that third aim that I put up in the beginning of inclusive growth? So I'm going to take these, each one independently, but I'm going to spend quite a bit of time on the first one, and I'll be a bit superficial because one could actually write a whole book on these four questions. In fact, I did write a whole book on these four questions. Anyway, so the first point, which I was just saying, was that this whole issue of directionality. And as I said before, you know, there's hardly anything interesting that's happened, at least in terms of investment in innovation in the world, that could be explained without looking at sort of some element of strategic choice that was present in different types of public institutions. But in fact, much more than that, the big technological changes that have actually affected production and distribution across the whole economy, what we call general purpose technologies in economics, in fact relied on huge public intervention across the whole innovation chain, not just fixing the public good basic research problem. And in fact, if you look at the innovation chain, so basic research, applied research, early stage financing for companies, and then go downstream even more on demand side procurement policies, what you in fact see, and this is really across the world, I'm going to be focusing on the US because of the ideology behind that US model, but you really see this network, as I was saying before, a breadth and depth of public activity across a network of different types of public actors, which have been absolutely essential in actually making big things happen, which then crowded in eventually the private sector. But this was not just fixing the science problem. If you just look at some of these acronyms here, these are all relevant to the US. So you have the National Science Foundation, the National Institutes of Health, DARPA, but also going downstream, the Small Business Innovation Research Program, which has provided grants and loans to small and medium enterprises in the US through procurement policy, so government purchases in particular areas. You have the biggest public venture capital fund in the world called InQtel. It's a CIA fund, so it should worry you a bit. Not FBI, CIA. We now no longer like the FBI since this week, right? The CIA still has saved face. But you know, it doesn't stop. So ARPA-E, which is the sister organization of DARPA, but in the Department of Energy, which has recently come up with one of the biggest innovations in battery storage, is quite downstream. They're not just doing basic research. And what's interesting is also the role that these organizations have played in fueling the feedback between these different processes. Because there's lots of serendipity in innovation, there's lots of uncertainty. The innovation chain is not linear. You don't go from science to commercialization. But this need also for constant feedback processes has also been fueled by these organizations. As I mentioned before, Small Business Innovation Research Program, which has been very important for providing high-risk early-stage finance to SMEs in the US. What's interesting, if you just look at these figures, at this figure here, which compares the private venture capital sector with this form of, it's not really public venture capital, but it's public finance to SMEs, is that the difference, if anything, has increased. And this shouldn't surprise anyone, precisely for the reasons we were hearing before through Henrik's talk, which is, you know, venture capital is very exit driven. They want that exit to happen in 3 to 5 years. They want that exit to occur either through a buyout or an IPO. But actually what innovation requires is not exit-driven capital in impatient finance, but patient, long-term strategic finance, as the Prime Minister of Finland was telling us before. And this patient, long-term strategic finance has been formed in different countries in different ways. There's not one solution. There's not one blueprint. In fact, the US doesn't have a public bank. Actually, apparently South Dakota does. One state does. I don't know much about it. But, you know, how one organizes this patient finance might, you know, be different. There's heterogeneous solutions to the problem, but for sure, innovation would not occur without it. And the usual sort of theatrical story that I do is on the iPhone, which is that, you know, the different types of both basic and applied research that were essential for creating the technologies that make your smartphones smart and not stupid and dumb and idiotic were in fact all publicly financed. So internet, GPS, Siri, and touchscreen display. And the real problem here is not so much to say, oh, Apple is not important, the state did everything. Of course not. Apple was hugely important and continues to be important, especially through the sense of design and simplicity. But the problem is the narrative. Where is that storytelling? And don't forget Plato. Plato said, well, he said lots of interesting things, but a very interesting thing that Plato said is the storytellers rule the world. And the storytelling that we do around Apple has been part of the problem in terms of both innovation policies that try to copy the US story without hearing the real narrative, but also in terms of fueling a problematic division of the profits that are generated from this more collective wealth creation process. But basically, you know, there's a book on Steve Jobs and on Apple. A film came out a couple years ago from the book by Isaacson. It's a very good book. But in that book, there's not one page, one paragraph, one sentence, one word on any of the public investments that, in fact, Apple very much surfed. And when we say surf, this is not a parasitic relationship. This is, that's what companies should do. They should be able to benefit from this, if you want, public finance. But when we then don't talk about it, when the discourse and the narrative ignores it, this is when great dysfunctionalities happen. And I will argue towards the end that lots of the inequality that actually Piketty does talk about, you know, from the 1970s going up, in some ways can be traced to this problematic narrative that we have on who created this wealth in the first place. And before I mention surfing, well, this looks like a wave, literally. I didn't do it on purpose. This looks like a wave that can be surfed, and that's exactly what happened in biotechnology. Private venture capital absolutely surfed a wave of publicly financed research, not just upstream, through the National Institutes of Health in the US, which provided that high-risk investor of first resort kind of capital to the innovation stream. They came in, the venture capitalists came into biotech in the late 80s, early 90s, and again, no problem. That's not a problem, as long as the narrative explains it that way, so then the share they get, which is usually 20%, should reflect what they did, which was coming in when most of the risk had actually already been taken. Okay, so this kind of rebalancing of risks and rewards should be a result of having a different understanding of where this wealth comes from, where this high-risk investment comes from, because we shouldn't forget, as I mentioned before, that lots of these investments fail. Innovation is highly uncertain. So if we want governments to play this role across the world and building these mission-oriented programs, and I'll say a little bit more in a minute what I mean by mission-oriented, then we better be able to think about what do we do when we screw up? How are we going to explain this to the taxpayer? And surely it doesn't help if we didn't explain to them the role that that the state has played in the successes, and they just hear about the failures. So in clean technology, and we heard quite a bit before about renewable energy projects, it's quite fascinating that we see, and there's a great database, by the way, called Bloomberg New Energy Finance, where you can literally see every penny that has been spent, or every euro that has been spent across the world on different types of renewable energy projects. And what you see is that the highly capital intensive areas which have high market and technological uncertainty are almost devoid of private finance. And if you literally take the data and plot it, now this is a bit simplistic. I'm doing some work with a colleague, Gregor Semenyuk, where we're looking at the risk landscape even within areas like solar, within wind, within marine. It's very interesting to see the sort of public-private collaboration, but for sure, something that jumps out, for example, is that development finance institutions, and that's quite a broad term, that includes different types of state investment banks like the KfW, have absolutely played the lead role. And it's not clear why, by the way, they should necessarily then pull out once these particular areas are successful, especially if you go back to this issue of risks and rewards. When is the right moment to pull out of a project? If you see these projects as constantly needing to reinvent themselves, that level of risk sort of doesn't necessarily go away if we have the role of these public banks and, again, transforming particular landscapes around different types of green missions. It's not that you just sort of provide some money, then you get out because the business sector is going to do its thing. This need to crowd in and to bring in private initiative into areas which continue to be characterized by risk-averse private actors is something that, at least in the green area, we really see this very large role that public institutions have played. Now, if you look at one particular public bank, the KfW, it's quite striking because on the one hand, it plays a very classical Keynesian counter-cyclical role. So just the years and the amount of disbursement. So when the financial crisis hits, the private banks retreat, lend out less, the famous credit crunch, and this particular public bank, as many public banks, I'm sure NIB did the same, increasing the amount of lending. But that's not the whole story. They directed that lending towards their Energiewende policy. And this is not just about, offshore wind or solar. This is about the green transformation of the entire economy. We shouldn't forget that, innovation has both all the supply side needs of basic research, applied research, and finance, but also demand side pull areas. And in fact, much of these climate finance projects are also related to that, if you want, demand side pull. But this notion that somehow this bank is, just leveling the playing field for Energiewende to then be chosen by the market is obviously false. These are specific decisions, specific investments being made around the green energy transformation of the entire economy. And while this is, quite known to your community, because NIB does this as well, in economics, we have a hard time justifying this. And so it's not a surprise that many public banks do get accused of crowding out the business sector without having, as I mentioned before, a clear understanding of how these spaces, that new way of thinking about green as a direction for the whole economy, how do we capture that qualitatively? Now, the China Development Bank is one of the lead actors, and these sums might look crazy to you in terms of the amount of lending to specific companies, many of which, by the way, went bust. But, Elon Musk, how much did he get from the U.S. government? Just yell out a number. It's up there. The number's up there. No. He got $5 billion. $5 billion, Elon Musk, one guy for his three companies, SpaceX, SolarCity, and Tesla. Then within those companies, like the Tesla S car, which without Scandinavia wouldn't be selling much. I think 30% of Tesla cars get sold just in Norway. The Tesla S car actually received a guaranteed loan by the Department of Energy in its early stage. It was something like $465 million just for the Tesla S car. Very successful, as you all know. $500 million at the same time was given to Solyndra, a solar company, which went bust. Everyone knows about that. That became the new picking winners problem. Why did the US government do this stupid thing of give all this money to this one company when, again, that's part of the game. For every Tesla, you will have six or seven Solyndras. But the reality is that almost the whole world knows that Solyndra was publicly financed. Very few people know just how much money Tesla has received, and also Elon Musk's other great ventures have received. But the real question is, does this mean a bank getting captured by a private interest to give money to a particular company, or what kind of mechanisms can actually be put into place so the steering of the finances towards particular companies that are willing to co-invest around new, for example, Energiewende kind of policies, what can we learn from that? And by the way, there's a colleague of mine that did a study comparing, for example, the same instrument, so SBIR, as I mentioned before, in the US, which gives money to innovative SMEs through procurement, same exact program called SBRI, they reverse the I and the R, in the UK, one really successful, one not successful at all, SBRI. And one of the key issues there was who was working in these agencies, who was doing the selecting of the companies. And in Britain, these were, well-meaning, nice civil servants who knew very little about the technology and the science and the economics behind these applications. In the US, they were scientists, top scientists often. In the US, they have even had a Nobel Prize-winning physicist running the Department of Energy. And he actually is the one who set up ARPA-E in 2009, which was part of Obama's stimulus program. Unlike Europe, the US actually had a proper stimulus, and not big enough, many would argue, but it was $800 billion. And it very much initially, at least, was going to be steered in this green direction, and ARPA-E was set up in that year. It ended up being run by this guy, Arun Majumdar, who ended up going to Google eventually, because he was so good. But this, you know, this issue of how do you bring in top investors, top scientists to want to work in these public institutions is a very, very important question, which brings me to the next point, which I'll get to in a minute, around organizational capacity. This point here I've already made. I'll just say that Carlota Perez, who is a very smart economic historian, has in fact looked at how over history, this kind of demand side, demand pull part of the story has been very important. So she looks at all the different technological revolutions, which I had put up there in the beginning, and sees things like, you know, mass production would not have had the effect that it did have without these demand side policies, which in that particular period of history occurred through suburbanization. People didn't just wake up and want to go live in the suburbs. That was part of a policymaking process which steered mass production. Now, regardless of whether we think, well, steered it and allowed it to become fully diffused and fully deployed, because there's no point in having these revolutions if they don't have an effect on the economy. And regardless of what one thinks of suburbanization, the big question today is what's the equivalent of suburbanization, you know, the role that it played for mass production in terms of thinking, for example, of the lack of full deployment and diffusion in IT. There's this, you know, joke amongst these two top economists, Solo and Robert Gordon, where they put the indoor toilet here and the internet here, and they say which one, you know, if you had to choose one, to have to still go outside and pee, or to use, you know, to send emails, which one would you want? And their kind of point is actually IT hasn't really had this transformational role in our lives yet in terms of the full capacity that it could be playing in both in businesses and households. And here the question is, could it be that we haven't had these bold demand-side kind of policies? Could green become a direction for IT to get fully deployed and fully diffused? So green beyond, again, renewable energy. Anyway, let me now go slightly more quickly around these other three points. And again, the reason I'm doing these four points is I do think that they are four pillars that are absolutely essential in order to create a different economic framework through which we can justify, evaluate, and nurture the kinds of investments that Henrik was telling us before that NIB does. So this point about the need for exploration, the need to actually take on risks, becomes really difficult when actually in most public organizations they're told, you know, not to fail. And we shouldn't, when I say the word mission-oriented, I literally mean mission. I mean, if you look at the websites of some of these organizations that I've been talking about, and there's many across the world, I've named already some, you know, in the UK, the BBC, NIB would surely be one. I'm sure you have a mission statement that goes beyond fixing market failures. These, you know, creating the organizational capacity and competence to take risks is also tied to how you define yourself. First of all, in terms of the talent you're going to be able to bring in. When you are a mission-oriented organization, like ARPA-E, it's much easier to attract really top people than get, you know, stolen eventually from Google when they're sick of working in ARPA-E, but that's normal, people do move. But when you instead form an organization which explicitly says you are there to just de-risk the private sector, to put bandages in these different places, to leverage up, to create enabling conditions, it's much harder, actually, to attract really top people because it's not really an honor to go work in an organization like that. And, you know, this is just sort of the first point, which is mission statements matter. They shouldn't just be trendy things you write, but actually really thinking through what an organization is for does also affect who wants to work in it. I spoke a lot with Cheryl Martin, who was the ex-director of ARPA-E, and I thought she had a really nice quote on what it meant to actually not just have a mission, but also in terms of, you know, how would you measure success? And she said, you know, we have to take risks, otherwise what's the point? We want to create that additionality and be doing what the private sector is not doing. And in fact, we measure our success in terms of how many risks we were able to take, and if we don't fail, there's a problem, but especially in terms of the impact of the few successes we had. But she also talked to me a lot about how they, in fact, nurture this kind of explorative and trial and error learning type organization dynamic. which I don't think has been theorized, as I mentioned before, enough. Albert Hirschman, a famous development economist, talked about the need even to welcome serendipity. He called it the hiding hand. I don't have time to talk about this, but this is really an area where if we could form a business schools that really trained civil servants and public actors to think about what it means to create learning organizations in the public sector, it would be quite transformative. Let me just skip a bit here because I want to get to the assessment issue. As I mentioned before, we must evaluate these investments, and we do evaluate the investments, but often if you look at the current ways we evaluate, they come very much straight from this market-fixing understanding of what institutions were for. So they pretend that there's an existing market. Let me just go to that one right away. I'll come back to these other ones, sorry. They pretend you have an existing market and you've put some bandages there, when actually what often happened is you've transformed a market and we weren't able to capture that, the size and the shape of that arrow and that new space. And this is a big problem. So this kind of static cost-benefit analysis still gets used, as much as we like to pretend that we have dynamic indicators, we don't. And why is this a problem? Let me just back up, sorry, I'm making you dizzy. Is, you know, when we have, you know, in some ways, these investments that I've been talking about are all examples of direct investments, not indirect. They're not just facilitating. They're directly financing something. This is the issue of directionality. And the whole point of that directionality is, in fact, to make something big happen, as Henrik was telling us before. And if we can't capture that, that's a problem. One thing is just, as a fact, many countries over-rely on indirect tax credit mechanisms. And there's some very interesting studies which show just how little additionality R&D tax credits have. For sure, the patent box times of tax credits, which maybe we'll have time to talk about in the discussion, but they're really problematic tax policies that just reduce government revenue without creating much business investment. But what we do see is that those countries that have more direct and then use the indirect investments as sort of just icing on the cake, but also that the direct part is, again, decentralized across different types of dynamic institutions, across the innovation chain, end up actually having more business investment. BIRD, the business R&D spending, tends to be quite low in many countries. It's quite interesting, by the way, the differences in Scandinavia of how much business spent. So Norway is quite problematic, quite low business spending on R&D. Finland and Denmark and Sweden are much better. But linking these different achievements in terms of actually getting the private sector to do what it would not have done anyway to the way it has been, in fact, crowded in through these different types of public programs is extremely important, also so as not to waste public money, because the indirect mechanisms sometimes are even more expensive than the direct ones. This is just a great quote, which I always put in here because I just think it's so wonderful. But Keynes, when I say he wasn't understood, I literally mean it. He had this wonderful letter he wrote to Roosevelt where he said, you know, one of the problems is that we often assume when I, Keynes, say the word animal spirits to talk about business investment, that you have lions and tigers and wolves. Whereas actually, often in the private sector, we have domesticated animals. We have guinea pigs and gerbils and hamsters and pussycats. And what does this actually mean for public policy? To get the private sector to want to roar, as a lion does, rather than assuming that you have a lion in a cage and all you need to do is take away different types of impediments, whether it's tax or reducing red tape, these complaints that we hear about all the time. Getting the private sector to want to invest in these interesting areas that Henrik was talking about before is very much about admitting that animal spirits themselves are endogenous to the investment mechanism. Business doesn't just wake up and want to innovate. It has to, you know, its expectations have to be built up. And they have to see that growth possibility, new market or technological possibility. And what I've basically been arguing is that historically, these kinds of opportunities that business sees are highly correlated with interesting types of dynamic public investments, which make things happen that would not have happened anyway. And Bill Gates, he actually invited me to spend a whole day with him in Seattle to talk about the green transition. He's been very clear. He says, government must lead, we will follow. But this is not the mantra that you hear, especially in Europe, I would say, after the financial crisis where we forgot that it was actually private debt that got us into the crisis. Public debt was then blamed, but this notion that, again, the public sector shouldn't lead, it should just be in the background, this is, you know, Bill Gates, who knows perfectly well where his fortune came from, again, surfing a massive wave of publicly funded technology, he's very interested in green. He says, if we want a green revolution, we must learn what happened in the IT revolution, and I, Bill, know exactly what it was. Government-led, we followed. And again, this comes back to the point of if we then can't capture that government leadership of transforming and creating that additionality, dynamizing in beyond just crowding in, we have a problem. And I mentioned the problem that I've witnessed just over the last year with the BBC, very different from the kind of green or IT landscape. And let me just, you know, sort of finish it there just saying that's a huge challenge and we're working towards that. So perhaps actually in terms of a follow-up activity, Henrik, we can talk about how with your own investments, how you are currently evaluating them and what and how you might also benefit from seeing how we are discussing across the world this need to capture the market shaping process. Lastly, my last 2 minutes and 41 seconds, big issue about inclusive growth, which was one of the big objectives I put in the beginning. This should not just be about redistribution, yeah, of the wealth. It has to start from this new narrative storytelling a la Plato of where that wealth came from in the first place. And I've very much been arguing through the capital of the state, the entrepreneurial state, that in fact the wealth itself has been co-created and the market itself has been co-created through these different types of public investments. And so what does that mean for creating kind of like a revolving fund through which the wealth can be plugged back in to future investments, which are really pushing the frontier, which will benefit our grandchildren in the future. So this whole financing of the future issue. And in fact, public banks are very much structured in a way that they can create this revolving fund because they often do, for example, retain equity, unlike an organization like DARPA or NASA, which is not allowed to do that. By the way, does anyone know what the top marginal taxation rate was in the US when NASA was founded under Eisenhower, a Republican military general? Just yell out a number. 75%. Higher. A bit higher. 91%. Okay, so in partly this whole risk reward thing, you know, is also dependent obviously on what the taxation system is and if the taxation system is working. But personally, even when it's working, I don't think the taxation system was set up in a way, you know, to cover, for example, this issue of these inevitable failures. You know, for every Tesla, you'll have lots of these cylinders, right? It was meant to, if you want, capture what government has to do more, literally in terms of the basics, you know, funding the schools, the hospitals, the infrastructure. But in terms of leading on the innovation front, why not rethink that space in terms of alternative mechanisms beyond taxation through which the sharing of rewards could happen? And as I've mentioned already twice, the whole Piketty story is an important story to look at, because why did inequality increase so much? Well, Warren Buffett, who was not a communist, is not a communist, tells you. They reduced capital gains tax by 50%, for example, by it, just in 5 years. But what's interesting in terms of how it relates to the story I've been telling is if you look at who negotiated and lobbied for that reduction in capital gains. And it was the National Venture Capital Association in the US, which in those years had just been set up, the association itself. And through this narrative of we are the risk takers, we are the innovators, reduce our capital gains tax, basically managed to become much, much richer. But that particular policy, as Warren Buffett here tells you, never even affected investment policy. That's not what investors look at. They look at opportunities. We also have a huge problem today, which was slightly touched on before in Henrik's talk, which is the increasing financialization of the real economy. I'm going to be quite brief because I think my time is up. But we don't have actually this reinvestment into innovation by the top companies, for example, in energy that we had in the early days with IT. But we should ask ourselves why. Where did Bell Labs come from in the IT sector? Bell Labs was a very important R&D laboratory inside AT&T, a private company. It was forced into existence. Government at the time was much more confident, understood its role, and said, you're a monopoly, AT&T. You need to, in order to retain your government-granted monopoly status, reinvest your profits back into innovation, big innovation beyond your sector. And today, where we have record-level hoarding in Europe and the US, and record-level financialization, And by that I mean the amount of money that is not plugged back into the real economy but is spent on things like share buybacks. And you'll just look at some of these numbers here, they're astounding, to boost share prices, stock options, and executive pay. This is a big problem. These kind of deals that we could be striking about reinvestment. Why? Because if the public sector was so important in creating these profits, well, at least let's make sure the profits are reinvested back in, and perhaps also with conditions attached like it was for Bell Labs. Big innovation beyond your own area. My last slide is this one, which is just to say, there's many different ways in which this sharing of rewards could be done. It could happen through the price system. You were just showing me that today a Danish company is in the news for being very problematic, a pharmaceutical company, and how it sets its prices. Most drugs are, most of the high-risk part of new drugs is in fact publicly financed. Why are the prices of those drugs not reflecting that public activity? We could have different types of equity. With Tesla, it's a very interesting story why the US government didn't retain any equity. We could have innovation funds, sovereign wealth funds, which in fact are set up precisely in order to capture some of these rewards with pressure to reinvest, not in the carbon intensive areas, but in, again, new areas which can capture, transform the economies of the future. There's many different ways to do this, but the point is we only begin thinking about this when we admit this active wealth-creating role of public funds, which then should be there to negotiate what's correct in terms of this give and take. Otherwise, what we get is lots of inequality in the name of innovation, and that's the story, I think, that Piketty didn't tell, how much of the regressive parts of taxation system have occurred through problematic innovation storytelling. And I'm hoping that this different type of storytelling around market shaping, market making can help both transform innovation policy as well as limit inequality. And I'm done.
Should
I stay here?
You stay here. Yeah. And if you stand in the middle, yeah, would you like some water?
Yeah.
It's here.
I got it.
By the way, just to say that actually you beat Piketty getting the book prize from The Statesman, which must have been quite rewarding. But turning to your presentation, your final point about the how we should get the rewards from innovation back into society, I'll come back to that. But let me just start in another place, because now you've come to the Nordic countries, which you could argue, actually, in terms of having mission-oriented policies. You take, for instance, the building of windmills in this country has been a mission of the green economy, has been something that Nordic countries have emphasized. But let me just start sort of as a general question, that you argue that we need smart growth, we need sustainable growth, we need inclusive growth. But the basic question of growth is very important. And just to start off, where are you in the growth debate? Because there are a lot of people saying that society, we've reached a place where we have to accept that because of pollution, because of the environment, because of the pressures on wildlife, we must just have to accept that we cannot expect to have growth in the future. Where are you in that debate?
So that's why I began with the issue of growth having not just a rate, but a direction. And I personally think that the debate should not be on whether to have growth or not, because we actually know that, you know, we would have unemployment unless we have growth. But the question is, what kind of growth? What kind of growth? And because we haven't admitted this transformational impact that governments can have, we haven't actually tried to direct that growth in particular ways that can really be sustainable. Sustainable, by the way, is not just renewable energy. So it's very important to say that, because otherwise, you know, a green mission is not offshore wind or onshore wind. A green mission is about transforming an economy in a green direction, and that can have a huge impact on different types of sustainability factors beyond just literally how many wind farms we have. And putting all your eggs in one basket, like too much wind or too much solar, we know can also create some problems. So retaining that diversity of the portfolio is also important.
Let me just say, questions and comments are very welcome at this time, and we have someone standing there and down there. So if you raise your hand, comments are as welcome as questions. Henrik, you've just heard this presentation of where we should go. For NIB, if you were to say, what can you learn from a presentation like this one in terms of the business model that you see for the Nordic Investment Bank? Is this just a confirmation of the model you have, or are you saying, this is where we should be going?
This is probably the most nasty question I've got ever, because now
you
want to go out on thin ice, because the worst thing with a government institution like NIB is that it is management that drives the institution. The management should manage the institution. It should be shareholders who defines what we want to do. Mm-hmm. Of course, management could, by luck, be inspirational from time to time, but I think that institution who gets their own life by just existing, they are failures. So the inspiration for me is basically that we have to look clearly at mandate, and we have to say what is the size, how much money have we got, and where can we make a difference? Because you can't make a difference everywhere. So that's one point I'd like to say. But one point where I would actually like to say we should spend a bit of money, that is, we talk so much about growth, but isn't the key that economists are very, very poor at measuring growth in the service sector? That's generally agreed upon. And I think we should ask ourselves a very, very simple question. Would you live today with a $10 or $10 in same PPP basis, the same parity, 10 years ago or today? Today, you get a lot of things for free. I'm fed up of hearing that there is no inclusiveness at all. If you look at it today, you can get as much music as you want for free for YouTube if you have a telephone, right? The richest man, woman, 30 years ago, couldn't do that. That's a big difference that has happened. So I disagree slightly, not totally. I would also prefer the water closet, just so you know. But I think that IT is significantly undervalued, particularly in the entertainment industry, which is the icing on the cake for most people. You can get the best artists in the world, the best movies for free like this. That is value that is not measured today. So I'm sorry, I think the economists have to do some jobs. Mm-hmm. They have to work a bit on how you actually measure the service industry.
By the way, can I just say one thing about services? Denmark, because again, we're here where Denmark is surely represented, one thing it's achieved, which is remarkable, and I think that story should be told, is that not only does it do renewable energy, you know, wonderfully, and it's one of the top countries in the world, but precisely because it's done it in a mission-oriented, visionary way, it's created synergies and spillovers between manufacturing and services. And Denmark apparently is the number one provider of high-tech services to China's green economy. And China's spending 1.7 trillion, 12 zeros on green. And so that whole issue of not just valuing services, but understanding how services themselves can flourish when you have a visionary strategy around innovation also in manufacturing, and creating those spillovers between these two areas is very important, especially in a country like the UK where the services we have are financial services, which haven't been plugged properly in with innovation.
But now you talked about spillover, if I might just provoke a bit, I agree on what you're saying from Denmark, it's nice to hear. But the Danes couldn't do it if we wasn't piggybacking on the Norwegians, because you couldn't have so much wind power if you didn't have hydropower from Norway that you could switch on like this. Otherwise, you had to have gas-fired power plants. And that shows me also that if you are a small region, cooperation is key to growth. That's the other side, because you very well point out the amount of money that should be spent on research. And we have to learn small is beautiful is the worst thing you can say to anybody if you want real growth. Then you have to say you have to have a certain scale.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have a question here.
Thanks a lot for a thought-provoking presentation where you focused on your visions, and you were so kind not to sort of be critical in terms of other directions. Our thoughts, but in trying to sort of get a sense of where you are on some of relative to other lines of thoughts, are you suggesting a larger public sector or just a different public sector? Are you going down the sort of the is your ideas and elaboration on some form of endogenous growth? Are you suggesting, and if we take that sort of in terms of the public sector, that sort of going down the message that we should actually shift sort of from towards more growth-inducing expenditures away from traditional expenditures, or just trying to box you in, but yeah. Get a sense of where you are relative to others in terms of your policy recommendations.
So there's different issues there, which are all very important. One is, in Europe, the countries that have the highest debt to GDP, like the pigs, and I'm allowed to say the word pigs because I'm Italian, a German couldn't, you know, Portugal, Italy, Greece, and Spain, are not the ones that have been spending the most. So deficits in Italy have been lower than Germany for decades. The deficit has been anywhere between 2 and 4%, lower than Germany's. But because it hasn't been spending smartly, it's not quantity, smartly, in the different ways that I've talked about before, and I'm not going to repeat the whole thing, then productivity has not increased for 20 years. I think only Namibia and Haiti or something have had less growth in GDP and productivity as Italy has. Apparently, the World Bank came out with these figures about the last three decades of growth. And so the point is not the amount of money. And by the way, indirect mechanisms that I mentioned before, which don't create much additionality, cost a lot of money. So stupid policies also cost a lot of money. So this whole issue of how do you set up public institutions, a network, so not all top down, how do you distribute it across the whole innovation chain, how do you make them mission oriented so they attract top level people, are all equally important parts of the story. You can throw lots of money at stuff and things don't happen if you don't structure that organizational capacity. That's the second point of organizations. That's why it matters so much. I could say more, but I think that's the really crucial bit. However, money does matter. So when we set up in the UK the catapults, which were modeled around the Fraunhofer's in Germany, these institutions that are supposed to create linkages between science and industry, we spent 10 times less than Germany. That does matter. Money does matter. But it's not the whole thing. You could, you know, spend the equivalent amount of the Germans and not set this stuff up right. It's also not going to work. And also procurement policy is extremely, you know, important. So this whole market shaping, market creating role also has a very concrete form in terms of the buy-in. It's, you know, in Europe, we don't use procurement policy as much as the US, and we could if we thought about it in terms of European procurement and really have it linked up with our innovation policies. That could create a huge amount of additionality in crowding in the private sector so they can scale up and you know, give a much bigger bang for the buck. So it's really about how to leverage the effect that these public funds have versus just saying, you know, how much. Having said that, just really quickly, because this is so important, the outsourcing that is currently happening across the world in public institutions, which is often outsourcing of knowledge, which then creates dumber public institutions, which then have a very hard time relating to some smart private firms, that is a problem. And that is often done to cut costs, to cut the size of the public sector, but eventually, because you end up doing lots of problematic things, which then have to be remedied later through different types of bandages, that as well is something I think we should really measure a bit better, how much public money is wasted by not having done things right in the first place, and the dumbification of public institutions by outsourcing their brains is part of the sickness.
But then aren't you just arguing that the public sector should be bigger?
No. Why do you keep going back to that? I just told you.
Yeah, because you didn't answer the question.
Okay, no, I just gave you the example. So Italy has a really high debt to GDP, which could be one form of public debt. So, so again, come back to Italy, but many countries across Europe are going through, in Italian we call it, la riforma della pubblica amministrazione, the reform of the public administration. And often this is just about cutting it. Now, even with a given amount of money, so this is the answer to the question, even with a given size of the public sector, but if this reform of the public institution is about using kind of public choice and new management theory to reduce any sort of notion of public and social value, so at best you're seen as an inefficient private institution, that's where the tragedy occurs. We end up dismantling public institutions with a given size, so forget the big or small, with a given X amount of money being spent on the public sector. If these are not smart learning organizations, if they're not distributed through networks, if they're not fueling these, you know, feedback effects across the investment and innovation value chain, then even with that given amount of money, it's not going to work. Having said that, yes, of course you need to spend money. That's what I was saying. I mean, just by thinking you can do the Fraunhofer's on 1/10 of the cost is idiotic. Of course that's not going to work.
But when you look at the data on how much public spending on R&D, but I know R&D and innovation, we have to talk about digital tuning, but just looking at R&D spending, for instance, in Denmark, and I think for most Nordic countries, the private spending on R&D is much bigger than public spending, roughly double.
D, not R. Depends. I mean, yep, those figures
but
are
this
very,
is the OECD data. That, but according to the way the Danish government measures it, then private is then, if you look at your argument, is to say, actually, we need to actually increase the public expenditure on R&D.
So one of the big problems we have today is not, again, the amount, it's what's happening within it. So it used to be, and I was sort of getting this to this at the end when I said where are the Bell Labs and energy, it used to be that top big companies were doing both R and D. And governments were also doing both R and D, but of different types. And again, it was more their interactions and how they were distributed across the innovation chain that made a difference. One of the dangers we have today, and there's been a recent very good article on this, is this very kind of false dichotomy where governments are told, stay in your place, just do the R. Business thinks it can sort of just do the D or just get the small, say, biotech companies, for example, and pharma to do the R and the big pharma can do the D. And actually that dichotomy, that kind of rigid dichotomy of who's doing the R, who's doing the D, doesn't capture this dynamic feedback between those two, even within organizations. And part of the financialization of the private sector has also made it think it doesn't have to do the R because it thinks it can sort of, you know, stay downstream and use open innovation as an excuse to make use of others' R. But also these wrong metrics that we have to judge public institutions. I don't know if you remember Mitt Romney when he was running against Obama. He even used ARPA-E as an example. He said, look, you know, of course I like the public sector, but why is ARPA-E doing applied research? They should just stick to their place, the basic research. And that really misses that story I was telling in the beginning, which is you wouldn't be able to talk about Silicon Valley or tell that story without seeing the breadth and depth of public activity across that whole innovation chain.
One question for you, Henrik, is that we heard today in terms of how you could now actually make the private sector contribute, sort of getting the money back in terms of saying that if you've used public funding for public research and made a new product, then the government should get its money back through, for instance, the golden share or patents or whatever. Could you see a role? Because when you look at your activities today, you have made loans to big corporations in terms of R&D. Could you see yourself saying, okay, you have to pay your loan, but could the role of NIB also be to actually be a vehicle where you said, if you then do great and the innovation is successful, we need more money, we need not 8% but 10% return.
We need warrants, yeah, but that would be an interesting concept. Thomas, you are asking very difficult questions because basically, remember, bankers are primitive people. And when you are a banker, you wear a bow tie. Because and suspenders, because as a bank, the margin we are having is very low. You want your money back, right? But if you go into R&D and if you go into seed capital or whatever, then you, as you rightly put it, there will be failures. And therefore, it's another type of people. You have to have specialists, you have to have scientists. So if I look at it from NIB's point of view, we could easily set up stuff like that. Green bank, whatever, but you have to say then you have a funding machine. Our competitive advantage is that we are a well-known brand, we can get money, we have the rating, so we can get money in. But how you disperse it, there's a huge difference between being a banker who wants its money back or being an investor who is looking for a return, because one, I kill dreams as a banker, the other ones nourish dreams and you are looking at the upside, I'm looking at the downside. It's two different business models.
Yeah, right, but the point you're making is actually that we need business models where we, as I understand your book, that we need the public sector. When it puts money in,
But I want a return, that's what I'm saying. I'm lending
because Mariana Mazzucato wants a return.
No, but I think it's fair, and that's what we are trying to do. We try to create a return, so we are not giving, we are not a development bank. So we give money, also when we lend money, we don't give it. We try to price it at market prices, but we don't go for the last pip. Our competitive advantage is longevity. But there you come into ownership. It's a very interesting question. You should do research on pharmaceutical industry in Denmark, which is foundation owned, and then look at it in Sweden, where it wasn't. It has completely disappeared in Sweden, more or less. And in Denmark, you have a huge thriving pharmaceutical industry because they are actually funneling money back, and it's much long-term investments.
But the
culprit here is not the company, it's the pension funds. The pension funds are the ones who are the bosses today. They are really the criminals because they are demanding a excess return. Take a bank. Why should a bank make 15% return after tax when interest rates are zero? Yeah. It's obscene. It shows that capitalism doesn't work if that's the case.
But you're suggesting in your book, you're suggesting you have a lot of suggestions on how we actually get this R&D, we get it back into the public sector because we need that they should share in the rewards.
So hold on, this is very important because people always misunderstand this. So, I mean, I'm not saying you misunderstand it, but when I talk about those people, so if government was just doing basic science, in some ways it wouldn't have to worry about this because, you know, basic science more or less spills over. And these spillovers are a way for the public to get back its return, right? Because the knowledge spills over also to other companies, which then pay tax or make, you know, create jobs, et cetera, et cetera. But even, okay, so there's 2 points there. But actually, government doesn't just stop there. It also goes downstream and funds specific companies, specific technologies, and when it gave the money to Tesla, Tesla benefited from it. Of course, Tesla will make a great car, which we can say that's a public return. We can all now buy Teslas. But it's very different when you go downstream, where particular companies are benefiting from these very high-risk government investments, where, again, for every Tesla you have a Solyndra. Those should be treated separately. But come back to the basic research, precisely because government has not felt the confidence to even be talking this way, it hasn't negotiated the right deal even on that. So in theory, you would have these spillovers as long as the patent system was working properly. What has happened over the last 30 years is we've allowed patenting to occur upstream. So tools for research, the research tools themselves are being patented. Also, patents are too wide and too strong, but patents are not rights. I don't know who invented the word IPR, intellectual property rights. They're contracts that should be negotiated. And government has lost its negotiating power and has allowed patents to stifle innovation and lead to unproductive, not productive entrepreneurship. But I was mentioning to you before, there's even an act in the US, which is called the Bayh-Dole Act, which was set up precisely to help commercialization. So before 1980, before this act, publicly funded research could not be patented. After, because they wanted to commercialize and help fuel biotech, which they did through this act, they allowed publicly funded research to be patented. But in the act, it says, we better be careful, government should have, if we allow this, the right to cap the prices, for example, of drugs that are publicly financed and that might eventually be patented. The prices of those drugs should be capped to reflect that public contribution, otherwise the taxpayer pays twice. It's in the act. The US government has never exercised its right, which is in the act, to cap the prices of drugs. And this is the whole storytellers rule the world point, which is if you don't have the right story of where these drugs came from in the first place, and something like 75% of new molecular entities with priority rating trace their research back to public taxpayer-funded money, then we don't understand, you know, even the price system. So this return, it's not just in terms of equity. It could be through the price system. It could be through the conditions of what is patented. It could even be conditions like the Brazilian investment bank, when they help the Brazilian generics industry to remain in Brazilian hands and not be bought up by multinationals, they made really specific conditions. They said, fine, we'll save you, private generic companies, but why are you making a pill that someone has to take 5 times a day? Make it one pill a day, because someone in a favela will forget to take 5 pills a day. So that's kind of the social return. The characteristics of the product, which is government financed, should also reflect the public value.
Then when you ask, say that, you could argue that, it, sort of to put it in the Piketty way, saying that what you're suggesting is that you have different vehicles, which, you know, you could call it an international innovation tax, like, because you're saying, is this possible if not all countries do it? Because now if you do it in one place, and I'm just mentioning this article that came out today, and all who own Novo shares are going to be very depressed about this, where Bernie Sanders is attacking insulin makers for their price hikes, particularly Novo Nordisk and Eli Lilly. I think this was the reason why Novo dived on the stock market today, and it's bleeding beforehand. But Novo is a Danish company. It has done research in Denmark.
Yeah.
But now, if you pay, buy the same product in the US, you pay $450 for the product in the US, you pay $70 in France.
Yeah.
This is a good business if you can stick to the $450. But can the system you propose, can that be managed, or doesn't it have the same problems as the financial transaction tax?
I think there's, again, lots of complex issues, but just take Apple when it was discovered, not that it was using these Irish schemes, which then the competition commissioner in the European Union went after both Ireland and sort of Apple at the same time. Apple was already playing those tax games in the US. It actually moved one of its subsidiaries from Cupertino, California, where all the research was financed, to Reno, Nevada, which is like a third world country inside the US, just in order to benefit from these, you know, tax arrangements which Nevada was implementing in order to attract capital. Now, both within the US, where states are fighting each other to attract capital with very problematic policies, but also, of course, across the world, I definitely believe that we should, especially within Europe at least, if we have a European Union, you know, be able to think of smart ways to not, how do you say, cause this race to the bottom. Now, it was ironic that Ireland was kind of defending Apple, saying, oh, we don't want the tax revenue. You know, I mean, that's how they attract capital, but that kind of capital is short-term capital. The kind of strategies that Denmark had around green, you know, that kind of capital that's attracted, oh, let's go to Denmark because we want to do green, and that's where the interesting conversations around green are happening. That capital lasts, it stays. But the same kind of these schemes, these different types of tax schemes that whether states or countries implement, you might attract capital for a short amount of time, but then, you know, the companies move. So Pfizer closed down its biggest R&D lab in Sandwich, Kent. It had been attracted there through different tax schemes. It then went back to Boston, not because Boston had a better tax system, but also because to be closer to these national institutes of health, but then they can also, you know, continue to move and play everyone's game. So they might want to, at one point in time, be close to these public R&D laboratories and move it over to a tax dodging area, and this is very problematic.
And the red light is blinking. Which, thank you very much, okay. Mariana Mazzucato. It's been a pleasure. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Time is flying. We are almost in check with the time. Now it's a pleasure to give the closing remarks to the Minister of Finance for Latvia, Dana Reiziniece-Ozola. The floor is yours.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. The 40th anniversary of the Nordic Investment Bank is a remarkable event, and I'm very honored to be here and make the closing remarks tonight. I would start with an old anecdote about the Latvians. The question is, so why did the Latvian put his money in the refrigerator? So the answer comes, he likes the cool cash. So really, the cool Nordic and Baltic weather infused cash means the cold and reasonable minds, and that's what we are really looking for in the financial affairs, aren't we? When the flow of the money is too heated, usually, and that's proven by the history, it's too tricky for us to handle it reasonably. It tempts us and provokes our primordial instincts with the easy or the hot money. Our markets sometimes go crazy like the dancers in the party with a lot of southern comfort. That's the favorite whiskey of Janis Joplin. I don't even tell you what happens when we are dependent on the Western or the Eastern money. Let's keep it short and seriously speaking, the cool, reasonable and targeted Nordic money is more sustainable for us than the Baltics, and it is not a big surprise that the Nordic Investment Bank has really become yet another example of splendid collaboration between the Nordic and the Baltic countries. We all know that the Nordic Investment Bank plays an important role in facilitating sustainable growth in the Nordic Baltic region. I'd like to refer to the Nordic countries in general as one of our closest neighbors that played a crucial role in supporting the Baltic states after we regained our independence, Iceland being the first country to recognize the independence of Latvia in August 1991, and continuous support from the Scandinavian countries during the transformation process of the Baltic states from the planned to the market economies. That was a turbulent time. 25 years of independence implied the comprehensive transformation of the government, the economic, political, and also social systems. And even though this has been a long way with a lot of mistakes, we can be proud of what we accomplished, what we have accomplished ourselves and together with the bank. You've seen the pictures in the movie. I mean, the pictures of those times, the change that has taken place is enormous. What is most important, the sustainability perspective for the long-term funding projects earmarks an additional dimension to the operations of the bank, which we commonly regard as a seal of the top quality. Within the past 24 years, the bank has provided 129 loans with a total amount of 2.3 billion euros to the customers in the Baltic countries, and the most remarkable projects being the upgrade of the power generation and power distribution infrastructure, the construction of the power links from the Baltic countries to Finland and Poland, and the launching of the LNG terminal in the Lithuanian port of Klaipeda, facilitating supply diversification and energy independence of the Baltic states. And you cannot really overestimate the importance of those projects to fight against the influence of the Eastern money in the Baltic states. Thank you once again for bringing the Nordic-Baltic area together in a very tangible manner by upgrading the transportation infrastructure, establishing energy links, as I already mentioned, and promoting closer economic cooperation in the region. I'm also glad to mention that our relationship was launched already two decades ago. Since 1997, the bank has financed number of projects that were important for Latvia. And during the years of our partnership, the bank has intensified its operation in the Baltic states, doing an incredible job on improving competitiveness and economic environment and the stability of the governance in our countries as well. I do believe that there are more opportunities for the bank to expand its presence and energize its activities in the Baltic regions, given that the availability of the EU structural funds that sometimes do overshadow alternatives of other international financial institutions will most probably start to decrease after the year 2020. And on top of that, we will face the impact of the Brexit effect already the next year, when the UK will most probably initiate the negotiations on leaving the EU. This is a signal for us, the Nordics and the Baltics, to put an effort in attracting funding more actively. As Scottish people say, don't marry for money, you can borrow it cheaper. Yeah. A lot has been done during these years, but we don't want to stop here. Instead, we are looking into the future, and the theme and the topics discussed today in this seminar, Financing for the Future, marks another dimension for the bank's future, built on the possibilities of innovation. Innovation plays a critical role in shaping our future, and so does sometimes even more the finance play. It allows or does not allow the organizations to conduct research, development of new technologies, commercializing new products and channeling them to the markets much faster. However, markets in general provide less finance for innovation that is desired today in our societies, and this is why it is important for the governments to make use of different types of interventions aimed at increasing the amount of finance available for innovation activities. I agree with you. This seminar is kind of special to me personally. In Latvia, we are currently designing the new financial strategy where innovation is a crucial element to define future path of the national financial sector and ultimate dynamic goals. Innovative services, innovation in technology, even innovation in regulatory approach will increase the availability of credit for borrowers and create new and less costly ways to raise equity, thus financing the future. The rapid development of the financial technology and innovation moves the center of the gravity of financial innovation towards the market players outside the traditional financial system, and therefore established trust and coherence of the whole financial systems should be maintained. The world is flat, the businesses develop, they become much more dynamic, and what is required from the governments and the institutions? They have to be as dynamic as the businesses. They have to follow the pace, and sometimes they need to become a bit more agile than the business and they have been ever before. And this is the great challenge, how to establish these institutions, how to develop the governments that do not only foster the success, but also remedy the failure. And I loved the point you showed in your presentation as well, because I see that's the big challenge of our governments as well. So a market really requires a set of well-functioning institutions in order to work effectively, and that's a challenge of the bank as well. So let me again thank all the participants and the bank for organizing this really useful and thought-provoking seminar. And at the end of my little speech, let me thank you, dear friends, for your warm hearts and the cool cash. Happy anniversary.
Deep down in your presentation, Mariana Mazzucato, you mentioned Robert J. Gordon's book on growth. It's a fat book, but I think the point of the book is that we can't take growth for granted, and we can't take for granted that new technology will automatically solve the issues that face our societies. And I think what is really interesting about your presentation today is that you bring to the forefront the debate on how we should have R&D contribute to solving the problem of growth in our societies and finding models where we can extract growth from R&D, both public and private. So I think your presentation today, also from what I've seen on Twitter going on while I've been up here, is that the debate has not far from it ended today. And I think Henrik did a wonderful speech also, in the sense that he almost convinced us that he's a boring banker. Almost. I think there's a bit more than a boring banker in the NIB that we were presented with today. I think when you look at the projects that NIB is involved in, for instance, R&D funding in some of the big Nordic and Baltic corporations, it plays a very interesting role in our economy, and is also an interesting case to follow in the years to come. So, thank you for having me moderate today's event. The only final remark I have to end with, and a very important one, is that now, on the behalf of NIB, I invite you all to attend the reception dinner, which is just below here, in the so-called Snapstinget. And Snapstinget, we found out because I met a lot of people from the Nordic-Baltic area before, and we agreed that the name Snaps need no translation in any of the Nordic-Baltic languages. So, have a good evening, and thank you.